right, thank you. Welcome everybody to the February 18th, 2020 meeting of the Falls Church City School Board. I'd like to call this meeting to order, and Ms. Cadeau, will you call the roll, please?
Yes, Mr. Anderson?
Here.
Ms. Dimick?
Here.
Ms. Downs?
Here.
Ms. Litton?
Here.
Mr. Reitinger?
Yep.
Thank you.
Thank you. Will you please rise and join me for the pledge?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. I would seek a motion regarding the agenda. Ms. Dimick?
I make a motion that the board adopt the agenda as presented.
Thank you very much. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Litton. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposition or abstention? All right, then the agenda has been adopted. We'll begin with this week's Spotlight, Team FCCPS, and I'll turn it over to Dr. Noonan.
Thank you, Chair Anderson. Good evening, everybody, and welcome. We're so glad you're here. Tonight, it brings me great pleasure to invite up to the table some of our best and brightest here in the City of Falls Church. We have Katie Johnson and Mark Coffert. So if you guys want to come join us, that'd be great. Mr. Coffert and Ms. Johnson are outstanding physical education teachers at Mary Ellen Henderson Middle School, and their principal, Valerie Hardy, is here this evening. And tonight, the spotlight on learning is on the new Ninja course that came from a grant through the Ed Foundation for Henderson. And I believe tonight we are going to see some of it in action. So with that, we'll roll the video, and then the board may have some questions for you.
At MEH PE, we're always trying to come up with new and creative ideas to get the kids engaged and get them active. We saw a need with the fitness testing. There's a definite lower score in regards to upper body strength that we'd prefer to be higher. One of the ideas came about just the popularity of the American Ninja Warrior show. As a staff, we kind of brainstormed and watched the show and came up with some ideas and thought about this space, because the rock room is very popular, but it also has a lot of open space that could be utilized. The Falls Church Education Foundation has the grant for teachers, and we wrote one with the American Ninja Warrior in mind and using this space, and it was amazing. We were rewarded with that.
There was no blueprint for us to actually go and follow this school down the road or this school in Iowa. As far as we know, we were the first group that has planned on implementing something of this magnitude. It really started with just a couple of Google searches, kind of figuring out what type of equipment there was out there.
We are limited to do what we can in the room because we are sharing the room with our wrestling team. And once the wrestling season is over, we can start our phase two and even phase three of the Ninja Room. Students have really enjoyed the first phase, but as they're hearing what's to come of the different types of equipment we're going to be putting in there, they are very eager and ready to see what phase two and phase three looks like.
First day, I thought it was really cool. I was really excited to see like what was going to be added to it, because it wasn't quite finished on the first day. We just got to kind of test some of the things.
As we watch our students use this equipment on a daily basis, it's still that learning experience for us. We're showing the kids option A, B, and C on how to accomplish the goal and the task that we've set forward. And students are actually using their creative minds to challenge themselves, challenge their friends, and they're using the equipment in a safe yet completely different way than we had ever even thought of.
Before the Ninja Room was like made, my favorite part of PE was using the rope, because it was challenging and fun. I like the Ninja Room because there's more variety of options I could do and more challenging things.
The Ninja Room creates an inclusive environment for our special needs population, which gives them ways to increase their coordination, their balance, their motor skills, and also allows them to be with their peers as they are in our Ninja Room.
What you see behind us today is like phase one and a little bit of phase two, and more stuff is coming in the future after wrestling season. And when the new building comes, the new George Mason, which will be great, it'll be nice to have this room full time, like Ninja Rock Room.
I'm sure there are going to be questions, because that was awesome to watch. So.
Yeah.
I will turn to other members first. Ms. Dimick.
Hi. I've told Mr. Coffrin this before. My son loves the Ninja Room.
He's full ninja.
Yes, he's trying. So at the end, you left off with when the new high school's built, will the Ninja Room be able to, we have to take down and put up?
Yeah, currently, that's what we're doing. Let me back up. I start by saying Mr. Nottingham sadly couldn't be here tonight. He has a sick newborn and a sick wife, and he's on the mend himself. So he wanted to come, but I said, nobody else wants to get sick, so stay home. We're all dodging that. So, unfortunately, one of the realities that we have is that we have to set it up every single day. And those wires that go across and the tight ropes and the slack lines that are called, it takes about 45 minutes to an hour to set everything up every single morning. And the gray mats, as you can see, are mobile, which is great. That's one of the best parts about those. But we are setting them up. When we've been doing that unit, and we're kind of in a mixed unit right now, but when we set it up every day and then break it down. And eventually, phase two will be this year when the wrestling season concludes and everything can stay in there. We won't have to take it up and down every day, which is ideal. And then eventually, when all of it's done in wrestling and they can, the new school wrestling is going to have their own facility, which I'm so happy for them that they have like a full-size wrestling facility. So. At that, we'll be at phase three before that happens, but that's just the idea.
Ms. Lynn?
I'm just curious, is this like a unit kids do for a while, or is it something you're able to use all year round, or how does that work?
Yeah, so with our student population this year of our class sizes bigger, we have that space utilized throughout the whole year, and we kind of do rotations. There are three classes at a time, Mr. Nottingham's, Mr. Coffrin, and myself. So to utilize the space in the gym, we will utilize that room on a continuous basis. So we definitely have started as a unit, but then progressively going throughout the year, so to utilize it. Yes?
Mr. Reitinger.
Thank you, Ms. Chair. So, first off, that was totally awesome. But I'm really annoyed because...
I know what you're going to say.
Well, first off, my kids all leave MEA.
Yeah, right.
They don't get to go to field day anymore, right? And not going to field day is maybe sad for them, but it's super sad for me.
I know, right?
It was always my favorite thing every year. But this is great. I wish you guys had thought of it 4 years before. Quick question. Have you thought about, like, reaching out to the show to see if... you know, they want to come and do something on it?
Well, I mean, we thought about the idea of, kids, some of them, I can already name like five or six that seem to have the skills that it takes. The one thing about the show is that they make it look so incredibly easy when you watch that. And then the reality from a teaching standpoint with our population at a, so let's say 665 kids, there's probably 20 kids that can do, you saw the slack lines, for example. They can do the slack lines without the bottom tightrope, like only about 15 out of, let's say, 660. So the other 640 are using the rope and using the bottom part, and it's kind of they're building their upper body strength, and some are progressing. But, I think in my grand scheme of things, maybe in the future we'll have a kid try out for it. I know it's coming to D.C. Some of the kids have already come to me and said that it's coming to D.C. as this year's the new television cast is happening there. So, I mean, who knows what could happen. We could maybe have a ninja team at some point. But, I mean, down the road, I guess. Yeah.
So I have a neighbor who is actually trying out for the Ninja Warrior show that's coming to D.C. They've already put their application in. And he's going through the process of preparing and training. And I've reached out to see if he can maybe come in as a guest speaker for our students, just to kind of talk about how to perform and how to train and just well-being and wellness. And so I think that would be a great thing for him to come in and kind of take us along his journey of preparing for this and just to kind of see what we've done for the kids. So that's a goal in mind that we have planned.
Thank you, Mr. Anderson. I loved watching it, and I think everyone by reading any type of information or publication on fitness, more and more strength training is something that we should all be doing more of. So I think, especially for our kids, that's a little intimidating. So I think to do it like that is great. They don't even realize that they're building that upper body right. strength because they're having fun. And I loved seeing students from the special education classes really doing something fun and working on their coordination. When you move into the new high school, do you anticipate that you might need more funding to round out the course?
I don't believe so at first. The space, the original plan that we had set up and the items that we had picked fit that space pretty well. And I think we've made some modifications with what we thought we'd purchase later with the idea of how things are working and how it's kind of turning out. Thinking about in the future, just the wear and tear on the equipment might be an issue. Right now, it seems, knock on wood, to be very, very sturdy. And so, I mean, we kind of spent extra money on those pieces, like the gray mats, for example, are very sturdy, and they're getting a lot of wear and tear, and just the flexibility of them is great. So that's something to think about in the future, though, like to add some new wrinkles or something like that. Absolutely.
Anyone else? Otherwise, I'll say one of the I love that video, and I'm liking this idea of trying to get somebody to come in who's already connected with it to sort of really get that fired up. Mm-hmm. I'm wondering about how much flexibility do you have, and when you watch with how the students are interacting with it, in adapting things and changing the course up, and making it sort of react to how they're approaching, you know, how they're actually using the course, and make it more challenging as they've done it more often, so they don't get used to the same thing over and over again.
With the first day and the students utilizing the slack lines in particular, we just told them just use the accessories. But then they themselves were coming up with really clever ways to push themselves and to challenge themselves. They were doing it with their eyes closed. They were skipping one. They were going backwards. They were challenging one another. So it was really great to see that. For themselves to come up with those ideas, and we were just kind of encouraging them and piggybacking on that with different ideas of ourselves. So with those slack lines, we were able to make it a challenge for them as well. And for those gray mats, they can move, they're mobile, so we can challenge it for different distances. We can stack them so that they can, you know, do vertical jumps as well. So we definitely have that fluidity of mixing it up. So, yep.
Awesome. Thanks. Any other last thoughts or questions? Thanks for coming out, and thanks for sharing us. That was awesome.
Thank you very much. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right. Well, we will move on then to 3.01, receipt of public comment. We have quite the audience with us tonight, which is really exciting. And I've got, let's see here. Something on the order of about 10 different speaker slips, so I'm going to just go in the order in which I got them and actually reach out to first speaker, Sean Dakin. And I'll just say, as Mr. Dakin's coming forward, in accordance with School Board Bylaw 2.30, the time for each speaker is limited to 3 minutes, and additional written statements may be submitted to the clerk for dissemination to board members and for the record.
So I sit here?
Yes, please, right. And use the microphone. Thank you, sir.
Great. All right, thanks.
And go ahead and give us your name and address for the record.
Thanks. Sure. So my name is Sean Dakin, and I'm a 10-year resident of Falls Church City, and I live at 124 Whittier Circle over by Larry Graves. So I'm here tonight as a current parent of a sophomore at Georgia Mason High School and a past board member of the elementary PTA, as well as a lead room parent at Thomas Jefferson. I'm specifically here to ask that the school board consider requiring all parents to acknowledge and read a statement that they must lock up their guns in the home. We must, as a community, work together to ensure that our schools are safe. Keeping our children safe in school means that we all must take responsibility in our homes. Our homes must not be the place where the next school shooter gets their guns because they're angry. Kids are impulsive, and they may make poor decisions out of anger and sadness and even fear that can lead to tragic consequences. Let's ensure that this is not our kid.
According to the Asking Save Kids program, which is done by Brady and the American Association of Pediatrics, one out of three homes with children have guns that are unlocked. Each day, nine children and teens are shot in gun accidents, and 80% of unintentional firearm deaths occur in the home. The Sandy Hook shooter had an arsenal of guns in his home that his mother purchased. According to a recent report from the American Academy of Pediatrics, the lead cause of death for children of ages 10 to 17 is suicide, and adolescent suicide is strongly associated with firearm availability. The AAP recommends that families with depressed teens develop a safety plan to restrict the young person's access to lethal means of harm, which includes firearm. My wife, Dr. Selena Dakin, is a pediatrician here in Falls Church City. At Kaiser. She is a head physician at Kaiser, and she sees many Falls Church City school parents and families, and she wanted to make it clear, she couldn't be here, that there are many more people in the city that own guns than you expect. She always asks each family at every visit if there's a gun in the home, and if there is it locked up? She has had several instances over the past few years here in the city where the parents did not lock their guns. To close, I'd like to thank you for all your time and attention and look forward to seeing this initiative move forward and hopefully be implemented in this year's InfoSnap, where every student must register their children and every parent for the following year. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. All right, moving on to speaker number two. I have a slip here from Isabel Afasio. Did I say that?
Yeah, we're going to put the statement together.
Okay, and who would I be?
I'm Aaron Tarpard.
Hi, Aaron. Okay, let me pull this up. Make sure I've got them together. Thank you. So, please go ahead and state your name and where you're from.
So, I'm Isabella Fazio, or Bella, and this is Aaron Tarpard. We're both ninth graders here at Falls Church City, and we're here to ask you guys about the Civic Engagement Day that we would like to implement. And I think you guys have been considering it to have it, and we think that's a good thing.
Bella and I are both active members in clubs within our school and the community. We feel so lucky to live so close to DC, where politics and civil engagement are very prevalent. A very memorable day in my life was the day I attended the Women's March on Washington back in 2017. However, I was only able to attend this amazing march because it occurred on a Saturday. There have been many protests and marches that I would have loved to attend, but was unable to because doing so would have cost me an unexcused absence at school. This is why I believe students like us should have the opportunity to make our mark in the community without the expense of an unexcused absence.
Yeah, so last Wednesday, I had the amazing opportunity to lobby in the Senate for something I feel really passionate about, which is the Equal Rights Amendment guaranteeing that discrimination isn't allowed based on sex, which is, yeah. It was such an amazing experience. I feel so lucky that I was able to go on a school day because my parents let me, even though it was an excused absence. Most students wouldn't have gone because it was an excused absence. I think by allowing one excused absence per year, it allows students to be active in their community and active with the politics that we're lucky to be around in DC. So I know it's civic engagement is important to me and a ton of other people at this school. So I hope that you guys consider the policy change. And thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Niharika Singhvi, acting in a student capacity.
Hi, I'm Niharika, and I'm a senior at George Mason High School. So I'll begin now. Society demands change, and civic engagement is the means for citizens to stimulate that change. As a youth, it's integral for us to be able to use our voice and create a better and more suitable world for ourselves, because after all, we are the future of our community. But the benefits of civic engagement exceed this rather general statement. According to a meta-analysis of studies conducted by the Association of American Colleges and Universities, civic engagement opportunities yield greater learning and increase graduation rates for K-12 students. Why, you may ask? Well, civic engagement is a way for students to transform textbook knowledge into real-world experience. By doing so, students constructively build their critical thinking skills, communication, and interpersonal skills. Civic engagement also motivates students to innovate, participate, get out, and make a difference in the community, and also become mindful of local and global issues. In turn, students become more engaged and well-informed, which makes them even better students. Along with educational benefits, one excused absence for civic engagement for students signifies thousands of more voices to be heard, voices that can and will make an impact. As students, we should be able to advocate and fight for what we believe in. Whether it's about gun safety, abortion, or equal pay, the issue doesn't matter. This isn't partisan. This is about our ability to go out and make a difference and to have the opportunity to do so on a school day if it's necessary. While missing a school day may seem to be significant now, we urge you to focus on the many benefits of civic engagement that civic engagement offers that not only include a platform for expression, but also improvements in a student's life and their skills. And remember, this day is there for only those who want it and will make use of their voices to affect change. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker slip is for Elizabeth Snyder.
Good evening. My name is Elizabeth Snyder. I'm a junior at George Mason High School, and a group of students, teachers, and I are here tonight to advocate for the school board to amend FCCPS attendance policy 9.22 to excuse one absence per school year for civic engagement, in a policy similar to the one that Fairfax County passed just a few weeks ago. I've been interested in this issue since Montgomery County introduced a similar policy last year, and other students have become interested in it too, as they've seen what Fairfax County has passed and wondered why Falls Church hasn't done the same. Students have increasingly taken on the role as advocates in the past few years. Mason has a Students Demand Action Club, Young Democrats, and Teenage Republicans. We've had a walkout after the shooting at Marjory Stoneman Douglas High School, and as the focus of student-led movements shifts from direct activism to direct political engagement at the highest levels of government, Mason students should be afforded better opportunities to make their voices heard. There's no better way to do so than by adding civic engagement to the list of reasons for excused absences. The International Baccalaureate Program tells us that student activism should not be limited to the school grounds. We should be involved in protests, congressional hearings, and meetings with elected officials. If I want to lobby my state senator in Richmond, I should be able to. If I want to speak at a hearing and it happens to be during the school day, that absence should also be excused. Yes, the FCCPS attendance policy excuses absences for reasons not outlined explicitly in the policy if the school principal approves, but leaving something so important and political up to the principal's discretion is a mistake. Allowing students to miss school without penalty for protesting or lobbying for a day each year is crucial to involving them in the political process and building the civically minded students that IB prides itself in. Students deserve to know, too, that the school district supports the fact that they are engaged. We have a great opportunity being so close to DC, and it's only right that we use it. One of the things I've realized in getting students together to advocate for this policy is that youth civic engagement doesn't belong to any one political party. There are students involved in this initiative who have different political views. Coming together to advocate for opportunities to advance their understanding of civics and government, despite ideological differences, because of a shared belief in the power of student voices. We have over 15% of the student body's signatures on petitions supporting this policy change, and we thank you in advance for listening to student voices tonight, and hope that you consider amending attendance policy 9.22 to allow students one excused absence per year for civic engagement.
Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Samuel Mostow.
Good evening, members of the school board. My name is Samuel Mostow. I'm a sophomore at George Mason. I'm going to pause up. Falls Church City Public Schools was the first pre-K through 12 school district in Virginia to become an IB district. We pride ourselves in our IB schools, whether it's the primary years program in elementary school, middle years program in middle school and early high school, and the diploma program towards the end of high school. Since kindergarten, the IB learner profile traits have been enforced and reinforced to students, emphasizing the need for students to ask questions, show empathy, and be communicative, which allow us to become better global citizens. Giving high school students one excused absence per year for civic engagement is a way that allows students to become better global citizens, which is exactly the intention of having IB and FCCPS. The best way to teach students to become better global citizens is to allow us to experience civic engagement firsthand. By allowing us one day per school year to clean a park or volunteer on a campaign or go to a peaceful protest, students will become better global citizens and better IB learners.
Thank you. Next speaker would be Ariana Hadid?
Hamid.
Sorry, I misread that.
My handwriting is the best. I'm sorry. Okay. Hello, members of the school board. I'm Ariana Hamid, and I'm also a sophomore, and I'm here today to express my interest for an excused absence given to all students who decide to miss school to exercise their First Amendment right to assembly and to petition the government. By allowing students to engage in civic activities, which often occur during school hours, this ensures that students' rights can be acted upon to the fullest extent. As you may know, Fairfax County has recently instituted a policy in which students may miss up to one day of school per year to engage in political activism, and their absence will be excused. We must follow the example of our neighboring county and make it known to all students in the Foster City school system that this school supports students in choosing to engage in activism. Today, the youth is more powerful than ever, and although we are young, we have voices, and it is the school's job to ensure that those voices are heard. When our peers were gunned down in their school, we came together in the hundreds to protest against this injustice. When our planet and our future is threatened, we stand with people young and old to make our voices heard and express our voice against this injustice. Recently, I and another student here went to DC to lobby members of the Senate to co-sponsor SJ Resolution 6, which will, with the youth-led movement Generation Ratify. Now, this will allow Virginia and other states that have ratified the Equal Rights Amendment to the ratifications to pass, and equality for all sexes can be ensured under the Constitution. Now, this experience was inspiring as I got to see high school-aged individuals come together from all over the country to come together for a cause they believe in. In a digital age, our attention spans are constantly being tested by insignificant apps and social media posts, and therefore the students that can break from the stereotype to become a motivated and valued student and valued member of society must be uplifted. And so as a school, we must educate our students. But I think that experiences such as activism are just as educational. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Grace Tarpgard.
Hello, my name is Grace Tarpgard and I'm a junior at George Mason. Thank you all for hearing us all out multiple times. So I'm just going to add a little 2 cents to what all my peers have said so eloquently. As the next generation of leaders and legislators, we deserve to have our voices heard. As citizens of Falls Church, we are also so privileged to live a short distance away from our nation's capital, where many of the most historic marches and opportunities for civic engagement take place. However, many of these events take place on weekdays, so they lack the student perspective. For this reason, we are asking for a measure similar to one Fairfax County recently enacted to allow us to do our duty to our country and ourselves by making sure democracy lives on through not only our words, but our actions. IB encourages us to be open-minded, risk-takers, caring, inquirers, and more. With the opportunity to take part in civic engagement, we can put these characteristics to use in the real world and fight for what we believe in, hopefully bettering our society for all. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Noah Zia.
Hello. To provide a short introduction to who I am, my name is Noah Zia. I'm a junior. Since I don't have much time, there are about 3 things you really need to know about me. 1, I'm a huge history buff, and 2, I'm a Foreign Service brat. 3, I'm a huge procrastinator, as you saw. These two attributes give me a unique perspective on a student's duty to society, and specifically giving students what they need to be civically engaged. I found that nothing helps me explain that perspective to people than this story. And don't worry, it connects to the whole thing. I remember walking through the barren streets of Kiev no more than a few months after the Maidan Revolution. The streets were almost deserted, barren besides the occasional taxi. The country had just started building its new democracy. What struck me after was the aftermath of the Ukrainian riots. It looked like downtown New York after 9/11. Lines of faces on missing papers, flowers, candles, under many of the faces that would never return to their families. However, one thing that struck me was the stark difference between the faces that I saw in the videos of post-9/11 and the streets of Kyiv. They were students, high school and college alike. George Mason students may not be fighting for their entire country's future or to overthrow a government which sent death squads to houses because they spoke out against it. But what we're doing here is just as important, because the fact that we are only 30 minutes away from our nation's capital and maybe too afraid to engage in a large civic event because of our academic career and how seriously we take that, living in Falls Church, is not okay. And those students in Ukraine showed me one thing, and that is by doing even the smallest thing, it is students and young people that can make the most change. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Coleman Gardner.
Hello. I am Coleman Gardner. I'm a junior at George Mason High School. And I just wanted to add a personal anecdote and kind of the student perspective onto the statement that my colleagues have so eloquently stated so far. I remember around late September when the climate strikes were going on, a lot of students were very passionate about this issue in particular. And a lot of students I heard personally, and myself included, were frustrated by the lack of ability to go do something. I remember specifically going in that day and expecting like 50 to 70% of the population to be off and away, you know, on sick leave to attend the protest. But I was surprised to see that a large portion of the student body was there, and I personally was surprised by this. So I asked around a bunch of students that day as to why, you know, they weren't at the protest, and a lot of the answers I got were because of this inability to get off a day without getting in trouble. So I just wanted to advocate for myself and others on the students' behalf due to a lack. In my perception, there's a major frustration on the students' part at their lack of ability to participate and support causes they believe in. I've seen this in like the climate strikes, or there's a March for Palestine, Women's March, and there is in the students' mind frustration as to their inability to support causes that they want to believe in. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any other students who want to speak? I do have two other slips, but they say very specifically after the students have spoken, so I want to make sure we give everybody a chance. All right, hearing no one, our next speaker would be Pam Mahoney. And Mr. Deal together, Mark Deal.
So we have 6 minutes. All
right, just oh, I didn't even think of that.
I'm kidding. I'm Pam Mahoney.
Mark Deal.
And we are the AP government teachers at George Mason, in addition to other government teachers in the building. I also teach IB Global Politics, and I'm the faculty advisor to the Student League of Women Voters Club. Anyone?
I teach AP government and IB business, economics and personal finance, certified French, that goes on and on. And have in the past sponsored Amnesty International as well as the senior meals.
Both AP Government and IB Global Politics actually require civic engagement activities as a core part of those classes. So this year alone, I just looked at my list, but I've had students attend the March for Life, help to register voters with the League of Women Voters, march to protest climate change, lobby legislatures. I have kids planning to work the polls on Super Tuesday, and then several have actually left school to go interview leaders for research on the topics for their engagement. And several are also calling you guys, so get ready for that. All of that is happening during the school day, except for your schedules. The administration at Mason's been great so far at allowing students to do these activities. But I think a school board policy that formalizes our community's appreciation would send a strong, for civic engagement, would send a strong message. I'm really proud of the kids who've organized this rally. It's been on my list of things to do to like ask for excused absences for all these things, but it was really the kids that pushed me to be here tonight. This generation of kids is different from the ones that we taught 10 years ago. Like, they're active and they really want to get out there. So I would ask you guys to formalize the policy to allow them to responsibly engage in civic engagement.
And ditto to all of that, and frankly, almost all of what I heard from the students. The only two small things I'd like to add, one small thing, one big one. I think this would be a really effective way for the school system and the school, George Mason, to allow students to engage civically and not ourselves have to be involved in the bureaucracy, of the process, okay, and get involved in the whys. Well, why do you want this day off? And I don't know my students' politics, generally. There are a few who are outspoken enough that I know. But broadly speaking, I don't know their politics. I don't need to know their politics. But if they want to be civically engaged, again, as Ms. Mahoney said, that's actually in the curriculum, both of IB and AP. It's technically speaking my job to facilitate that. And so I think that alone is a valuable goal. The only other thing I will say as one of the older people here, I've been civically engaged myself since I was, I think, 10 years old, handing out leaflets for a political candidate in New Orleans. I've kind of seen that be a good thing and be a bad thing, right? And we've all seen sort of the lack of civil discourse over issues that's mounting. I've gotten to know our students at Mason very, very well. Not only do I know them, I've really come to trust their sense of justice, their sense of responsibility, and the thoughtful way they approach the problems that we face in our society today. And if our students can be encouraged in any way to engage and participate civically, what that means is that 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, 40 years, 50 years from now, they will be leading civically, and they will be engaged in that manner. And frankly, I like the idea of them doing that. And if we can encourage them to build the foundation that will lead to that in the future, this is a no-brainer. So thank you very much for your consideration.
Thank you. And I will take a small deviation from the norm on this, simply to say it's not normal for us to respond to public comment, but I just want to say thank you all very much for coming and speaking so eloquently on something that's clearly so important to you. So thank you for coming and sharing your evening with us.
Mr. Chair, can I further deviate?
Only
because it is such a deviation. I just wanted to also say thank you as the superintendent. I have been in school systems now for nearly 30 years, and I think about the advocacy that our students bring forward in a variety of different circumstances and settings. And not often do you have a chance to see a group of students who are so thoughtful, so caring, so articulate and eloquent about what it is that you're advocating for. And tonight, for me, was a reminder not only of the incredible talents of the students that we have in the city of Falls Church, but how when you organize and when you get together and you think critically and you problem solve and you do all the things that IB asks for, you really do have the opportunity to affect change. And I just want to say thanks for being here. For those of you that do know, sometimes I do put some things on Twitter occasionally. And I would just love it if you wouldn't mind standing up so I could just get a quick picture of you. And so that I can show the world that you guys are advocating on behalf of your school system, yourselves, and your advocacy. And tonight was that first step, because if you weren't here advocating for being an advocate, you may not get what you were after. So I want to recognize that. So would you mind standing up just for a second? Come on, don't be shy. All right. Mr. Benton. Okay, here we go. Ready, one, two, three. Thank you. Thank you for that opportunity.
Thank you. And again, thank you all for coming and speaking so eloquently on this. It's excellent to see our students reaching out to us like this and speaking so eloquently on a subject that is so important to them. So thank you. With that, Ms. Goodell, are there any other requests that we have at this point? Any other?
No.
Okay.
I just have petitions that were signed that I can pass around so the board can look at.
Please, thank you. All right, with that then, we will move on to our school board work session number 3 on the budget of item 4.01, budget questions and responses. And I will turn this over to ask questions if there are any additional questions that any members have based on the new material that we received. Ms. Downs.
Thank you, Mr. Anderson. This is actually not based on the material we received, but I just wanted to ask Dr. Noonan, with the recent, revelation that there's going to be an increase in property assessments, if you could just talk a little bit about how that will affect our budget.
Sure. I can a little bit, but a lot of it remains to be seen. As you all may have read or seen or heard, it looks like the average assessments went up by about 3.9% across the city. And when the general government presented their fiscal forecast, they were projecting just north of 3%. What was it, Ms. Michael? 3.6%. So there's a delta of about 0.3 percentage points between what the actual additions are. So we are working closely with the general government, speaking with Kieran Bawa, who's the chief financial officer, and also Mr. Shields, to see what that'll mean down the line. We anticipate it could mean some additional revenue. We just don't know how much at this point, but we're hopeful.
Are there any other questions? Here we go. You give me the same expression. Okay. I have just an observation to make, but I'm also wanting to make sure that we get questions answered if there are any. Then I'll just observe myself, Ms. Michael, again, thank you to you and Ms. Kopic and the whole team, because throughout the questions that I've asked, all of the answers have been very detailed and given me the information that I'm looking for, and I really appreciate the effort that went into creating this. So I think I have a much better picture with all of those answers than we did at the beginning of the process, and I appreciate all the information and the effort. If there isn't anything else from anybody on this matter, we can move to our next item on the agenda. So I am looking around to make sure. All right. Our next item, we have a closed meeting coming up, and I would entertain a motion related to that closed meeting. Mr. Webb.
Mr. Chair, pursuant to Virginia Freedom of Information Act, I move the board convene a closed meeting for the following purpose: to discuss or consider the identified subject matter personnel under section 2.2-3711A, one, in particular, staff appointments, staff reassignments, staff resignation, staff retirements, staff performance, staff change of position, dependent care leave, long-term medical leave, child care leave, request for leave of absence, and advisory committee appointments. That's a mouthful. And student matters under section 2.2-3711A, two, enrollment of non-resident tuition student and non-resident student admissions and tuition interrupted residency.
That's some sort of a record. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Litton. Ms. Goodell, would you? Call the roll, please.
Mr. Anderson.
Yes.
Ms. Dimmick.
Yes.
Ms. Downs.
Yes.
Ms. Litton.
Yes.
Mr. Reitinger.
Yes.
And Mr. Webb.
Yes.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
To the yellow. 15 minutes.
Okay. This may take something on the order of 15 or 20 minutes, so we'll be back after that.
Mr. Chair, I move reconvene in open session.
Whereas the City of Falls Church School Board has convened a closed meeting on this date pursuant to affirmative recorded vote and in accordance with the provisions of the Virginia Freedom of Information Act, and whereas Section 2.2-3711B of the Code of Virginia requires a certification by this school board that such closed meeting was conducted in conformity with Virginia law, now therefore be it resolved that the Falls Church City School Board hereby certify that to the best of each member's knowledge, only public business matters lawfully exempted from open meeting requirement by Virginia law were discussed in the closed meeting to which this certification applies, and only such public business matters as were identified in the motion convening the closed meeting were heard, discussed, or considered.
Yes.
Ms. Dimmick?
Yes.
Ms. Downs?
Yes.
Ms. Litton?
Aye.
Mr. Reitinger?
Yes.
And Mr. Webb?
Yes.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much. We will move now to 7.01. School Board Appreciation. And I guess I'm turning this to Dr. Nooney.
Unless you want to appreciate yourself.
I think that's a little awkward.
I just wanted to take a minute. As I think everybody here may or may not know, February is School Board Appreciation Month. And we are very fortunate, I think, in the City of Falls Church to have such an extraordinary school board of engaged folks that take your work very seriously. And I see day in and day out, not only with the questions you ask, and we could use the budget as the example. We had 38 or 39 questions with the budget. Your engagement around that, your engagement in all of the school policy that you set, and the work that you do to ensure that we have strong leadership in our school division is greatly appreciated. And I think tonight was a great example for me in many ways to recognize you for the tone that you set also in the City of Falls Church for the students that you serve, which at the end of the day is what this is all about. The fact that we had 20 odd speakers here tonight from our high school to speak to all of you about potentially changing a policy is pretty extraordinary. You don't see that in very many places, and I think it's because you all have relationships with your constituents, you know your families, you know your students to a great extent as well, and there's a comfort level and an understanding of each other that make it easy for our students to be able to come to you, and I appreciate that and see that as your superintendent, feel very fortunate for that. So on behalf of the staff, the students alike, we wanted just to say happy School Board Appreciation Month to you. This evening on the walls, you'll see a number of things that are up for you from Thomas Jefferson, and we've got something from the high school, and we've got something from the middle school, and we've got Jesse Thackeray, and everybody's represented here tonight, Mount Daniel as well, just of appreciation for the work that you do day in and day out on behalf of our kids. So with that, I do have some certificates that I'd like to give to you tonight, Greg, you're first, Mr. Anderson. It's from the Virginia School Boards Association Certificate of Recognition to Greg Anderson in appreciation of your dedication and service to excellence in education on behalf of the students of the Commonwealth of Virginia. School Board Appreciation Month, February 2020, and it's signed by Rodney Jordan, the president of VSBA, and also Gina Patterson, who is the executive director of VSBA. So, Mr. Anderson, thank you very much for your service. Appreciate it. Ms. Dimmock.
Ms. Downs?
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
These are these slow, awkward moments. Ms. Litton.
Thank you for your service. Appreciate you.
Mr. Reitinger, thank you very much for all you do.
And Mr. Webb.
Ms. Downs.
That's Ms. Russell. Who's not here tonight.
And we have one missing. And awkwardly, we don't have one for Laura.
Oh, I gave one to Laura.
Okay. Yeah. I missed it. Okay.
All right. Thank you all very much for everything you do.
Well, thank you. And at this point, I get to have the pleasure of honoring another member in this room. It is also, for those who don't know, Virginia School Board Association School Board Clerk Appreciation Week. And although we did warn Ms. Goodell we were going to do this, I feel like I need to emphasize that. I will also read that we have a certificate for you from the Virginia School Board Association Certificate of Recognition, Marty Goodell, in appreciation of your dedication and service to excellence in education on behalf of the students of the Commonwealth of Virginia. School Board Clerk Appreciation Week, February 17th to the 21st, 2020. Also signed by Rodney Jordan, the president of VSPA, and Gina Patterson, the executive director. And a little something else that I get to give you on behalf of the board. With thanks.
Hey, Marty.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Chair Anderson, may I request that there be a picture taken of the board and the clerk for posterity, please?
I would be happy to do that. Where do we
All
stand?
Right. Perhaps over by
Am
the
okay.
the hands and the paws.
Marty in the middle with your flowers.
With my flowers. These really are beautiful flowers.
And there's a card in there. We should always card. It's kind of got lost in
No.
Oh,
sorry. Everybody's looking at John first.
Okay.
Oh, it's just you. Now let's start.
Here we go. One, two.
Thank you. As we're getting reset, I'll just say, Marty, personally, thank you very much for everything that you do to keep my job as chair squared up. Folks may not be aware, there's a lot of stuff that Marty does that makes my life a lot easier. So thank you very much. Oh, I know you do. And Ms. Russell asked that I pass her thank you as well and appreciation as well. So thank you. All right. The consent agenda, I would seek unanimous consent to approve the consent agenda as presented. Seeing no objections, so ordered. And we will move now to business on the agenda. Business item 9.01, 02, and 03, which are budget motions. So I would seek a motion related to the budget. Unless Dr. Noonan, you have any final comments you want
to make? I would be pleased to make just a quick final comment. First and foremost, I want to just thank a few people for their incredible work and support on the budget over this season. As you know, the budget isn't something you do in isolation, and it's not something that happens overnight. And there are two people in particular in the room tonight that I want to recognize. The first is Kristen Michael for her incredible work as our Chief Operating Officer, and Michelle Kopic, who's in the back as our Budget Director. Both Kristen and Michelle, on any given night, if you came into central office at 8 or 9 o'clock at night, were here burning the midnight oil, making sure that the budget was together and that all the questions got answered in a way that were easily understood and accessible for everyone. And I just want to take a quick second to thank them for their incredible work. I also want to take a second to recognize and thank William Bates, our Chief Academic Officer, and Tricia Minson, our Chief Legal Officer, for their incredible work supporting our budget as well. Both of them, along with Ms. Michael and Ms. Kopic, were instrumental in getting out into our schools, and the time that you all took also as board members getting into schools, listening to the feedback sessions with our staff, Giving everyone an opportunity to give us a sense of where they thought we should go with the budget was really important. And also would like to thank the representatives from SEEK, PEEK, EEK, and our SAOs for their input on our budget as well. So I'm pleased tonight to be able to pass the superintendent's budget onto the school board as the school board's advertised budget, in hopes that it will meet with broad unanimity. So thank you very much for your continued support.
Thank you, Dr. Noonan. Before we do take any motions here, I would like to ask if there are any comments that anybody on the board would like to make before we do that. Mr. Reitinger.
Just briefly, and I've said this before, but I'd like to add my, and I'm sure the rest of the board's thanks to both Dr. Noonan and Michelle and Kristen, because it was a really wonderful set of materials that you produced for us. It enabled us to look at all the materials in full context and make a good judgment. And it turned out that the superintendent gave us a very good budget from the start, so I'm very pleased and wanted to thank you as well for what I'm sure were many, many, many hours of work. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Reitinger. Any other comments? If not, I would like to echo that and say thank you, because it is very obvious how much effort went into this and how much care went into this. The questions that we asked, we got very thorough, very detailed answers to it, and helped me understand the context overall and answer some tough questions in helping me make some choices. So thank you very much for all of the work that you and Ms. Kopic did, and the rest of the team as well. So. Unless there are any other final comments or questions, I would entertain a motion related to the alleged the operating fund budget. Mr. Reitinger.
Mr. Chair, I move that the Falls Church City School Board approve for submission to the city manager the advertised 2020-2021 operating fund budget in the amount of $54,594,282, which requires a city appropriation of $44,596,706, plus 50% of any additional general government tax revenue above the December projections as determined by the City Council FY 2021 budget guidance of 3.1% on December 9, 2019.
Thank you, Mr. Reitinger. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Litton. Ms. Godot, will you call the roll, please?
Yes. Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Ms. Dimmick?
Yes.
Ms. Downs?
Yes.
Ms. Litton?
Yes.
Mr. Reitinger?
Yes.
And Mr. Webb?
Yes.
Thank you. The motion.
Thank you very much. Next, we will move to 9.02, and I'll ask for any final comments on the food service budget. Seeing none, I would entertain a motion related to the food services budget. Ms. Downs.
I'd like to move that the Falls Church City School Board approve
for submission to the city manager the advertised 2020-2021 food service budget in the amount of $1,103,600.
Thank you, Ms. Downs. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Dimmick. Ms. Goodell, will you call the roll, please?
Yes. Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Ms. Dimmick?
Yes.
Ms. Downs?
Yes.
Ms. Litton?
Yes.
Mr. Reitinger?
Yes.
And Mr. Webb?
Yes.
Thank you. Motion passes.
Thank you. And then moving to our next item, 9.03, are there any comments or questions on the Community Services Fund budget? Seeing none, I would entertain a motion related to that. Ms. Dimmick.
Mr. Chair, I move that the school board approve for submission to the city manager the advertised 2020-21 Community Services Fund budget in the amount of $2,419,126, requiring a total city appropriation of $107,500.
Thank you, Ms. Dimmick. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Webb. Ms. Goodell, okay. We call the roll, please.
Sure. Mr. Anderson?
Yes, thanks.
Ms. Dimmick?
Yes.
Ms. Downs?
Yes.
Ms. Litton?
Yes.
Mr. Reitinger?
Yes.
And Mr. Webb?
Yes.
Thank you.
Motion passes.
All right. Thank you very much. With those motions, the superintendent's proposed budget becomes the school board to advertise budget. And I get to take a visit up to City Hall on the 9th. All right. Moving on to our next item on the agenda, 9.04, school board liaison assignments for 2020. And Ms. Russell asked that I sort of help take care of this one as she is ill tonight. So you all received, I think, the list of liaison assignments that was proposed. And I think we all had time to make multiple rounds of comments. So I don't know if there are any other questions or comments anyone has related to this. Okay. I would just take the moment to say thank you to Ms. Russell in her absence for all the work that I know that went into this. And I know that she consulted with all of us multiple times. So I appreciate her thoughtful approach to this. So. If there are no other comments or questions, Mr. Webb.
Just a quick comment about the VSBA liaison, and if someone delegate, is there going to be an assigned backup just in case I can't make the conference?
I don't believe that that's been formally discussed.
I can reach out, but we can move forward with this right now. But I'll reach out to Shauna, and we can discuss that and probably have a backup plan just in case.
Ms. Litton?
In the past, I know we did have a backup because Aaron was the backup in the past. So
right. And so if we were to carry in that tradition, the chair being the backup would be a sensible approach as a start. But we should please talk about this one, and we can always approve an addendum to this if we need to. Any other thoughts or comments on this? All right, then I would entertain a motion related to the school board liaison assignments.
I move that the school board approve the school board advisory committee liaison assignments as presented.
Thank you, Ms. Litton. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Downs. Ms. Goodell, do you think we need a roll call, or is this voice vote, you think? Voice vote, I would think. Voice. All right, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposition or abstention? Hearing none, that's approved as well. Thank you. And now we will move to 9.05, approval in the second reading and adoption of policies. And I will turn this over to Ms. Minson.
Good evening. We have two policies for second reading tonight. The first is policy BDA, regular school board meetings. This would replace the current bylaw 2.23, which had previously been partially replaced by another one of the lettered policies. Following first reading in January, there were no proposed changes to this policy on regular school board meetings. Any questions about proposed policy BDA? Hearing none, the second policy for this evening is policy BDDH, public participation at school board meetings. This policy would also appear at policy KD in the community section of the school board policies, and it would replace school board bylaw 2.30. There was one minor change at line 16, making the word say if the school board had any further information, the member could address the speaker with permission of the chair. Any questions about policy BDDH? That's it for our second reading for tonight.
Okay, are there any questions? I did see, Mr. Reitinger, you made the I'm about to ask a question face. So, all right, thank you, Ben. All right, just checking. All right, then if I would entertain a motion related to these policies. Ms. Downs?
Mr. Chair, I'd like to move that the school board approve second reading and adoption of policies BDA, regular school board meetings, BDDH, also policy KD, public participation at school board meetings.
Thank you very much. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Dimmick. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed or abstain? All right, the motion passes then, thank you. And we will move on to 9.06, approval of first reading of policies.
Great. For first reading tonight, we only have one policy. It's policy IIBEA, which would also appear in GAB, Acceptable Computer System Use. This policy would replace two current policies, 8.32 and 9.40, which is titled FCCPS Internet Safety and Acceptable Use of Electronic Media. There are some notable differences between IIBEA, GAB, and the current policy. What I've presented to the board is the model policy with red lines or in red font, the proposed changes to the model policy. I appreciated you all looking over this. I also appreciated the colleagues that I had that worked on this for quite a lengthy amount of time, trying to figure out what do we do to make sure that our students and staff are protected while also ensuring that we provide computer systems for their use in their education. And I know, Mr. Redinger, you had sent some comments tonight, and I'd be happy for you to share this with the board or for me to do so, but certainly given your eagle eye and your background in this, appreciate your input. So I guess the first question would be, does anyone other than Mr. Redinger have any questions or comments or concerns with these policies, or should we just dive in with the expert?
Mr. Redinger.
Okay. Well, thank you. By the way, Ms. Minson, I thought it was an exceptionally well-done policy, and I thought your changes were really good. I have done this for about 20 years, so I thought I'd make a few suggestions. Great. And they're just relatively, I think, in context, minor ones. In the second paragraph, on the first page, in lines 19 through 24, I suggested making a few changes to make the scope of authorization clear, because sometimes the words used were perhaps more narrow than they needed to be. So I'll just read the version as I suggested with changes, or I can say what the changes are if that's helpful. Any communication or material generated, stored, or accessed using the computer system, including electronic mail, social media posts, instant or text messages, tweets, real-time communications, including audio and video communications, and other files and content, including communications and materials derived from a user's account, may be monitored, read, used, disclosed, and or archived by division staff, consistent with law, regulation, and guidelines. So there were a couple of purposes there. One was to avoid, when you talk about material generated, if you just, for example, take a file and stick it on the drive, you want to make sure that's covered, so that's why I added words like stored. Wanted to make clear, because there's special sensitivity around real-time communications, that those may be monitored by both people and security devices as well. And then at the end, I think it's valuable, especially as when it's written as broadly as it was, and I broadened it even more. My suggestions are to broaden it even more. That doesn't mean that everybody is monitored all the time for inappropriate purposes. So I think it is valuable to add some language that the monitoring needs to be consistent with law, regulation, and guidelines. Presumably that any monitoring would be for a security or educational purpose, for example. Those are the sorts of controls that are usually not written in the policy but will be in the guidelines. And so for my first set of changes, it was broaden the language and then add a little bit of a caveat that isn't really a caveat, it just makes the intention clear that the monitoring, we're not living in a panopticon, but we monitor, or the school system, I should say, monitors for legitimate purposes.
And I think those changes are all excellent.
Any comments on those suggested changes on that general text? Ms. Towns.
Thank you, Chair Anderson. This isn't so much regarding Phil's comments, but I did have a question about the technology use guidelines. This policy states it's a user's responsibility to know and follow this policy and the technology use guidelines. I was just curious, in terms of students, do we require students to read through that? Do they have to sign it?
Yes, that's a great question. So the technology use guidelines are regulations that are developed by the superintendent. And in the past, there has been a sample letter that goes home to families about the policy. And in the student section in the past, students have signed it when they receive their computers, and staff members sign it when they receive their credentials and logins. Okay.
Is it part of InfoSnap? Okay.
Yes, it is.
I seem to remember it. That's why it's all coming back to me now.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments? And then I know, Mr. Reitinger, you had some additional changes suggested as well, but please go ahead.
Oh, okay.
Mr. Reitinger.
Thank you. In line 27, on page one again, the sentence currently reads, the policy applies to all users of the division's computer system. By using or accessing the computer system, the user agrees to abide by this policy. And I added, and consents to its application, to make clear that a user has consented to all the things in the prior paragraph. I suggested.
I also think that's a good suggestion if the board is amenable.
Okay, continue, please.
The next one is really more sort of a question, I think, mm-hmm. for Ms. Minson than there are some comments, but it deals with the paragraph that rolls over from page 2 to 3, mm-hmm. beginning with line 42 on the second page. The first sentence says, software or services for instructional use by students cannot be installed unless approved in the educational approval process. And I sort of wondered why the statement was limited mm-hmm. to software for instructional use with students, because the negative pregnant of that mm-hmm. is that if it's software that's not for instructional use, there's no divisional control over what that is. And then the last sentence of that paragraph sort of makes that explicit. It says, staff and students may install and download software and or services to enhance their personal learning and productivity. I've honestly never seen anything like that in an acceptable use policy. Usually the restriction is, only approved software can be installed. And this says relatively explicitly that, if somebody wants to install a piece of malicious code or an unvetted app on their system, that there's no control over that. I mean, there's an implicit, it says, may install and download software for their, enhance their personal learning or productivity. So I guess the question for me is, what's the rule really going to be for installation of third-party software, including browser extensions, and do those things need to be explicitly approved, or is there a limited class where they need to be approved? But I would definitely say if we don't mean to say that it's a free-for-all in terms of installing software on your FCCPS-issued mm-hmm. laptops, we ought not say that.
Right. As far as the first sentence, and I think you're absolutely right, we need to say that software and our services may not be installed or downloaded on the division's computer system, with the exception of instructional use software that has been approved through the educational software approval process. So I'll retweet that language so it's explicitly clear. As far as the second sentence in that paragraph, that staff and students may download and install software and our services to enhance their personal learning and productivity, the discussion that the team had when we talked about this was if a student is working on a particular project for MYP and they need to have software online, or if a teacher is using a program to put together data, we'd want them to be able to use that. So I can go back and speak with Dang and Steve Knight to see would there need to be an approval process of that at each school level. Ms. Michael?
I think part of the conversation with instructional staff was with Apple, they really felt that students or staff needed to be able to download apps that help them, whether they were apps that help them with tracking a to-do list or keeping track of homework or logging milestones in a project. And I think it was that concept of should we allow students with their Apple ID to download apps was part of that conversation. And I think they really felt like giving people the tools that they needed to be more productive was really what led to this language. And I don't know that that's the right answer, but that was the conversation that I recollect.
I would suggest a narrower statement, quite honestly, because you know I think that's a perfectly valid point, but you know, not every app, even in the authorized app store, is appropriate to be installed on the school laptop. And so you know, there's either got to be some limitation or some sort of control. Mm-hmm. And I would just I would suggest that the language mirror what the policy really. And I don't know what that is. Mm-hmm. I think that you know, it's a question of risk tolerance.
Right.
So, mm-hmm.
Since we are hoping to bring this back for second reading and adoption next month, with the hope that it can be an updated policy for registration purposes and InfoSnap, what could we get some maybe guidance from the board or what your risk tolerance is, so that we can come back with language next week that would be or next month that would be amenable to the group.
I have my own idea, but I want to let others have a chance to chime in first. And actually, Ms. Singby, I'd like to also ask you, sort of, your experience and how, you know, what you've heard so far, how that would generally work for students. But
I'm just like trying to think of different scenarios because I know some people would like find a loophole in this policy and like download stuff that like could be used as personal learning but could also be like misused. But then there's also cases of students that. You know, could have viable or like actual necessary needs, but you know, aren't able to download something because of this policy. So I'm just like sort of like weighing, you know, just different scenarios in my head right now. Yeah.
Thank you. Other comments on this one? As I say, I've got some, but I want you all to have a chance first. If not, I guess I would just observe sort of, I'm in an environment where we also have a very firm acceptable use policy, and even though there are plenty of tools that we would like to be able to install for our own productivity, there is actually an app store that I have access to that has only very limited number of apps, and if you try to install anything outside that domain, the installation software just dies. And you know, so you have the ability to go and get some tools that are on a whitelist, effectively. And the policy basically says if you try to install anything that's not on the whitelist, you're in violation of the policy, and all the usual, you know, warnings apply at that point. So, Ms. Litton.
But I'm sure you've all experienced, like I have on my work computer, how frustrating that can be.
Oh, yeah, of course.
So, yeah, I just don't even know how we find that, you know, that right balance. And who monitors it is probably really the difficult part. I'm looking at Ms. Mahoney because as a teacher, you know, I don't know. I don't have any answers, only questions.
The other thing that occurs in saying that, you know, we have this whitelist and access thing is the workload that's involved in maintaining that list and vetting the tools that are on it is non-trivial, so it's just another consideration. Ms. Downs.
I agree. I am not lending any sort of suggestions, just to say it's a tough call, because I also think it's really depends on students' age somewhat too. You know, so if you're talking about MEH versus, you know, juniors and seniors in high school, you know, I think that the judgment, you know, of our older students is there maybe to handle, figure that, kind of go through that process better than per se an MEH student. I know that we've heard people at the MEH, parents of MEH students who have had concerns that there needs to be tighter control at MEH. So, but again, I'm not sure. I don't know if that's specific to this one sentence we're talking about right now, but I would just throw that out there.
Ms. Timmy.
I guess I'm wondering if there's a way to limit it to their academic work. So not personal learning and productivity, but something that they need for their actual school work. That doesn't maybe relate to staff as well. I guess I'm thinking students, that doesn't, because one could enhance one's personal learning and productivity reaching the next level in a game,
But that is not what, you know, yeah, I don't know.
That's right.
So I might suggest, although we could be more detailed here, that we punt, right? So I'm taking, you know, Mr. Castillo's not here, but his guidance is always that we should, or if he were here, he would be saying that we shouldn't get too detailed, that we should leave a lot of this to the school administrators. My, you know, in terms of sort of overall risk tolerance in the process, you know, I'd want to talk to Ding and Steve Knight and those sorts of folks. And maybe that doesn't actually need to be in the policy. Maybe we could just stick a sentence in that says something along the, you know, software, additional software applications, including browser extensions, are to be installed only according to school policy. And then, you know, or school regulations, or reference the regulation. And then Dr. Noonan and Ms. Minson and team can write out what all of those are and can refine it with a higher degree of agility than we can adjust policy.
Mm-hmm. And along those lines, I would offer that it just the first sentence could be sufficient, and it could be simply software and or services may not be installed or downloaded on the division's computer system outside of the educational software approval process, and then the details of how that all works is part of that educational software approval process. And
So listening to all of you tonight, I think what I would like to do is go back and talk with our team, to talk with Dang and Steve Knight and some of the other folks that are on the ground in the schools and some of our teachers to find out sort of what is the reality, so that I can have a better or help provide a broader perspective about what's happening, because some of what you're talking about already happens as well, and I want to make sure that we don't write into policy anything that becomes overly redundant and perhaps becomes problematic. So if it's all right with you, why don't we go back and try to have that conversation and craft some additional language or reduce the language as necessary.
I'm seeing lots of heads nodding. Mr. Redinger, you had a couple, I believe one more comment. I don't know if you want to bring that forward or not.
The last comment I'm just happy to flag, but it's a, you know, my level of caring on this is pretty small, and that's the sentence added in the next to last paragraph on page 3 that starts, the school board is not responsible. So the sentence was added, the school board is not responsible for any loss, damage, or unavailability of personal information stored on the division's computer system. To me, at least, that's wholly a subset of the first sentence, and so it's unnecessary. Because that says the school board's not responsible for any information that may be lost. But there may be some desire to be especially explicit about this, given, you know, students leave and then 2 months later they don't have their access to their personal information. So I think it's completely non-harmful. It's just, you know, legalistically speaking, unnecessary. So I don't feel that strongly about it. And if it gives added comfort to have that degree of notice in the policy, I'm perfectly fine with it.
I think that's exactly what it did. Dang did think that that would be helpful for him and his team.
Comment withdrawn.
It is nice to be able to point to that.
And can I just clarify on where it says, or for any information retrieved from the internet? You think we've covered every single thing in those sentences, that's enough, and that second retrieve from the internet doesn't in any way wipe out the previous information?
I think it's a or struck me. What do I know? But the school board is not responsible for any information that may be lost, damaged, or unavailable when using the computer system. That's the part I think that covers it. And then the or for any information retrieved via the internet, you know, I'd be perfectly comfortable with just putting a period after system, because I think even the or for any information retrieved from the internet is duplicative as well. But like,
okay.
Are there any other thoughts on this one? Otherwise, I have a question, Ms. Minson, about process, but sure. Any other thoughts on this one? So my question on process would be, would it be more appropriate to go forward with first reading with the sorts of changes that we have discussed here, or to delay first reading and potentially waive first reading at our next meeting if we felt like the policy had developed appropriately. So I'm curious.
I would propose going forward and having first reading. Often on first reading, there are tweaks and changes that then will be incorporated for second reading. So I don't see a need to not have first reading today.
Okay. And it leaves the door open for third reading if necessary. We've done that before.
At least once that I can remember, yeah. Are folks comfortable with that approach then? Okay. All right, well then, unless there are any other further comments or questions, including Ms. Singby, if you've had any scenarios pop to mind, but it's okay if not, I just want to make sure we've got a chance. Okay. Then I would entertain a motion related to this policy. Ms. Litton?
Mr. Chair, I move that the school board approve first reading of policy IIBEA-GAB, acceptable computer system use.
Thank you, Ms. Litton. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Reitinger. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposition or abstentions? Seeing none, first reading and the motion passes then. Thank you very much. Moving on now to 10.01 future agenda items. Does anyone have any items they would like to suggest as future agenda items? Ms. Lynn?
Can I just ask a question, and it's partially a process question. Given that all our students were here tonight bringing forward a request for policy, how would we go about possibly considering a policy related to the issue they'd brought forth?
I've been working with Dr. Noonan on putting together what policies are coming next. The attendance policy is a fairly complex policy that's going to require a broad group of people to be part of that process to review. That said, I think given what the students had to share, how incredibly persuasive they are and the sense that I'm getting from the board, I would propose that we could have a slight tweak to the attendance policy or have a separate standing civic engagement policy until we're able to spend the more thorough time reviewing the attendance policy, so that if the board wanted a civic engagement policy for this semester, it could adopt one as soon as either February if you wanted to waive first reading, or March if we do first reading in March, then could adopt a policy in April that could be in place for the last 2 months or so of school. I do think it's going to take a little bit longer to look at our comprehensive attendance policy and moving that policy towards a VSBA model policy.
Thank you, Ms. Spencer. Dr. Newman?
Certainly, that approach is available to you. It may be worth having a work session at some point just to talk about what the current policy is so that you have a fuller understanding of how decisions are made with respect to what is excused, what isn't excused, how those decisions are currently made, and then talk about what potential ramifications there could be. I'd like to hear from our high school principal, I'd like to hear from our middle school principal, particularly with respect to what they hear and what they see in their schools around civic engagement, and then also in some ways tie it back to what are the requirements of IB, so that we, as we engage in the conversation, that we make a pretty robust decision about whether or not we want to allow it. I think it is something that all of you would be interested in probably pursuing. I just want to make sure that we have the full picture before we move full steam ahead, if that's acceptable. Otherwise, we can change the policy next week.
Comments, thoughts on this particular idea? Ms. Reitinger.
So I'm a little bit of two minds on this. I thought the student inputs were superb, and it was great to see them. One of the things I was thinking is that, you know, this is a valuable thing to do, but I actually have no doubt that our school administrators would approve an excused absence for appropriate civic engagement I'd be shocked to learn one of those was ever turned down. So it's not an emergency in that sense. I'm sure it's handled with the appropriate types of discretion right now. But I think the students made, and the faculty, made a number of good points, including that, you know, having at least a clear rule that you can do one day of civic engagement sort of can also get the administration out of the loop of having to do things where, you know, things that may raise questions about, you know, approval over content. You know, for example, if a student wanted to engage in something that was considered detrimental to the school. I don't object. I think Dr. Noonan's proposed approach to a work session is the right way to go. And I think we ought to look through the attendance policy and do that the right way. But I also don't object to establishing sort of a temporary rule that, you know, one day that you should be granted at least one day excused absence to do civic engagement, you know, so long as it's not a limiting rule. For example, I could see cases where, you know, for example, Mr. Hills might approve several days of civic engagement. It also seems odd to me. At least one of the speakers and one of my kids spent a fair amount of time at Model UN recently, and so, you know, I'm not sure that going to Model UN is any more valuable than going to Capitol Hill and making those arguments for real. So all that's to say, I think the work session is the right approach, but I'd be happy to follow the will of the board on whether, given the input we had, we want to create a temporary rule for at least one day of civic engagement.
Ms. Downs.
Thank you, Mr. Anderson. I would second what Mr. Reitinger suggested. I think a work session would be valuable. For example, I don't know, would this policy also apply to MEH students? And I'm not sure if we talked about that. And if it does, that's, to me, very different. And I think parents could be concerned that those students are younger. And I just think that there are just some things we should talk about and work through and make sure we have all the input from the administration. But I do agree with Mr. Reitinger that, you know, the whole idea of it, of course, I'm very supportive of that. So if there is maybe something temporarily we could do for the spring and then dive into it a little deeper.
And I would agree as well. I think we definitely should do a temporary policy to give the students the opportunity to take advantage of the many ways that they can participate in some type of civic activity. I do kind of what Ms. Downs just mentioned. I would potentially, for right now, limit it to the high school students. But within that work session and coming up with a more bigger picture policy for that, I think then we can look into a little bit more of adding MEH. Because I know those kids are, there are several of those students who are already thinking civic-minded as well, and may want to participate in those things as well. But I think we need to think a little bit more about those students when it comes to that.
I don't mean to cut the communication off, so you guys can continue. I just wanted to make sure that currently, anytime there is an absence, whether it's at elementary, middle, or high school, the parent still needs to call in and tell the school that they're not going to be there. So knowing that, it still would be a parent decision whether or not their student would be absent for that civic engagement. So for example, if it was a middle school student and you wanted to do something temporary, the parent would call and say, my child is going to be out today. Staff, attendance line would say, why? And the parent would say, civic engagement. And that would be it. And I think there is some value, frankly, not only in continuing with that policy that parents call, but making it that simple to get away from any kind of judgment, any kind of, and sort of taking the administrators out of the decision-making process. And so, for example, in our neighboring district, they've simply added a checkbox, you know, is this for illness? Is this for a death in the family? Is this for civic engagement? You know, whatever the case may be. And then we would go through that. The other part of it that I just would need to get clear about, and part of the reason that I want to make sure that we at least do, at some point, do a work session, even if we have an intermediate policy, is the tracking of that. So how many times has a student put in for you know, civic engagement, because if we're not careful, you know, and not thoughtful about it, a student could put in three or four, a parent could put in 3 or 4 days for their student. So I know that surrounding jurisdictions have said 1 day. And by the way, I think it's a great idea. So I want to put that out there and would support our students engaging in civic engagement for 1 day of excused absence per year. But I just want to make sure we do it right.
Mr. Ryan.
If I might suggest a path forward, perhaps we should return to this at the next meeting. And Dr. Noonan can speak a little bit more to the school administrators, particularly the principals at MEH and GMHS, about what the practice is around civic engagement. And it may be that we can wait on a work session and simply just have a resolution about the sense of the board that, you know, appropriate absences for civic engagement are already and would be approved, and that would serve in an interim capacity until we were able to do a full work session. But it would make sense to me to at least hear what Dr. Noonan's feedback was after speaking to the school administrators to understand the degree of urgency. I think there's a degree of urgency, and we want to address it simply because we had such a powerful set of requests from our students, and I think we have a responsibility to move on that. But we ought to move in the right way, and perhaps we should get a little bit more information first.
Ms. Dimmick, or Ms. Singby, I'd be open to hear your thoughts.
I guess I would like to find a way to move forward with something that students could use, and I do not want it to be limited to the high school.
Ms. Singby.
I would just say that since I know there are a lot of events coming up, that if we could do this as soon as possible and like have a policy drafted before the next work session or meeting, that would be great. And I know like a lot of people are waiting on this to happen, have been waiting for a long time. And I also would think that, I think Fairfax did it from 7th to 12th grade, I'm pretty sure is the policy. So I think I would say that if that's working out for them, then we should also do something similar here.
Well, the sense I'm hearing is there's support for an interim action of some sort, and Mr. Reitinger suggested a sort of a sense of the board resolution after a bit more information at our meeting in March, and then a deeper dive in a work session, perhaps associated with gathering information for the full revision of the attendance policy in the next couple of months, perhaps. Something along those lines anyway. But I'm hearing the idea that at least a temporary action set up for March along the lines of some sort of a sense of the board resolution that can be used to give guidance would be kind of the sense I'm getting from everyone. I'm seeing lots of nods and no disagreement with that, so I think we should probably plan on something along those lines. Are there other future agenda items? Mr. Reitinger.
Well, keeping with the discussion of issues that were raised in public comment, I think it would be appropriate for us as a board to look again at what we can do around gun safety and school safety. That's a key issue for us. Mr. Dakin, as I'm sure everyone knows, has been a tireless advocate for gun safety and preventing school violence. I think the specific suggestion that's been made about whether to at least have, you know, to do something around informing parents about the need to lock up guns in the home through InfoSnap or otherwise is a worthwhile topic to discuss. It's fairly action-oriented and something within our scope of responsibility. So I think sort of talking through that at a work session would make a lot of sense, preparatory to the opening up of InfoSnap, if that's possible, for the next calendar year. Sorry, the next school year.
This leads to a question of what is that opening look like?
It's coming quickly. Actually, we're revising the handbook that goes online now, and registration will begin within about the next month. So I understand what your desires are, why don't we go back and have an internal conversation about how we might be able to sort of think this through and perhaps bring a suggestion to the board at the next meeting with respect to a path forward around whether it's gun safety, whether it's health and wellness, whether it's sort of, I'm sort of envisioning a broad list of really important things to remind parents about as you're registering your kids for school and getting ready for the coming year. Here are 5 to 7 things you probably should keep in mind, and perhaps that's one of them.
And if I'm remembering the documentation that that Mr. Dakin brought forward, there's been a couple of other divisions recently that have adopted a policy that is generally that sort of information transfer, not requiring any particular action other than the guidance to the school administration to develop information to share with the parents about the importance of gun safety. That's something that's potentially something we can do without needing any additional legal authority, unlike some of the other ideas that had previously been brought up, I think. So I find myself in agreement that that's something that we really should take a look at, and that's something we could consider, but I would need some more information on how that would actually potentially work here. I don't know what others think about that.
Thank you. I agree, and I think it speaks to building a caring community and a caring culture and looking at the whole student. So I agree.
Mr. Webb.
I just have a quick question. Are other school divisions in this region or any other places do such things of within the what Mr. Dakin is kind of talking about potentially us doing? Just more of a informational question than anything. It's something that I would fully support, but I was just wondering if neighboring jurisdictions and or other states and cities may be doing something similar.
I'd need to look into that.
So the sense I have looking at the table is this is a topic we definitely would like to talk about at an upcoming work session. But exactly when, given that March, end of March is the timeline for InfoSnap, maybe at least when we meet again next, you could give us some more information would be helpful.
Happy to do so.
Okay. All right. Are there any other future agenda items that anyone would like to propose? All right. Not seeing any at the moment. We will move on then to 11.01, our superintendent's report, and Dr. Noonan.
Thank you. A couple of announcements. Sort of the way I've been doing this is going school to school. And I'll start here with Jesse Thackeray, the lottery interest forms for tuition-paying students. We received 45 respondents. Our team has randomly selected those who can apply, and those who can apply have been notified at this point. Everyone else is on the waiting list, and the final number of tuition-paying peers that we accept depends on the number of special education ESOL and ESY students that we get. So they get precedence. We are looking forward to Read Across America on March 2nd. We hope that all of you can participate as a guest reader, and we'll get some information out to you about that. At Mount Daniel, we celebrated the 100th day of school on February 13th. I don't know if any of you have ever participated in the 100th day of school at Mount Daniel, but it's one of the funniest days of the year where the little kindergartners come dressed up like 85-year-olds with, you know, walkers and canes and the like. But it was great to see. Family STEAM Night was last Thursday at Thomas Jefferson, and a big shout out to our amazing Tosin Editoro. She's been highlighted here a couple of times at the school board for her incredible work. And that work, along with the great support from the fifth grade students and community partners and parents, really made the STEAM Night excellent. Mary Ellen Henderson, if you haven't had a chance to get your tickets to Mary Poppins, now is the time to get your tickets for Mary Poppins. And if you go, you're going to have a supercalifragilisticexpialidocious time. I promise you that. And if you go on Thursday, you never know who you might see in the show. So I just kind of leave it at that. It is going to be taking place Thursday, Friday, Saturday in the GMHS auditorium. And a huge shout out to Lisa Gross, Miss G, for her incredible work with the drama students, and to Miss Carpell as well, the outstanding choral director at Henderson. George Mason High School this year saw the most students ever honored in the District 10 Honors Band, and we're really proud of the work that they've done, those students. Placement in the three ensembles in the department, ensembles depended upon a highly challenging audition comprised of scale, sight reading, and prepared songs. Students auditioned into those three bands, one for middle school and two for high school students. And the performance at Hayfield Elementary with their peers from other schools is amazing. The MYP project is coming up. For those of you that haven't had an opportunity to be part of that, on March 11th is really an outstanding day. George Mason is looking for community judges to visit and chat with students about their projects. So if you're available between 12 and 2 on March 11th, it's a great opportunity to see IB in action for all of our students in the MYP program. This year, I wanted just to give some information about the staff intent to return. I shared some of this with you previously, but staff forms were sent to 455 staff members to determine their intent for the 2020-21 school year. 97% of the staff did respond to the form, with 4%, which is 18 staff members, indicating that they wouldn't return for the 2021 school year. It was an equal split, 9 each between licensed staff and support staff. 7 of the licensed staff are not returning, are teachers, and at this time there have been, as I indicated at the work session the other night, no special education resignations or retirements, and then 6 of the support staff aren't returning, and those are paraprofessionals, 4 of which are in special ed. So we are going to have some paraprofessional positions to follow up on. But if we hold at that 4% turnover rate, that's pretty amazing. And really speaks volumes, I think, to your leadership as a school board and to the work that happens with our schools. We've been talking a little bit about upcoming work sessions, and I just wanted to put on your radar again. We are anticipating that in March we would have a work session on the equity policy, perhaps an equity statement, equity policy, a conversation about where we are working through the equity audit. In April, we are intending to bring forward a work session around standards-based grading. And in May, we are looking at the future of school calendars. And I think our questions that evening are going to revolve particularly around when should we make the calendar and for how many years should we make the calendar? Is it possible to two-year calendar? Is that something you all have some interest in doing? So I did want to take just a second talk about a couple of things that we're working on that are beyond sort of the highlights of the school. The first is around standards-based grading. As all of you are familiar at this point, we have been engaged in a pilot around standards-based grading. There continues to be some really great work around SBG at Mary Ellen Henderson and at the high school. However, we do know that this year was a pilot year. And we had a number of places where we were not as successful as we wanted to be. And so as a consequence of that, we have pulled back in the standards-based grading pilot in particularly a couple of math classes and in English classes, specifically students who are in 11th grade. I think one of the things we learned from the pilot very quickly was students who are coming towards the end of their high school career was not a good time for us to begin looking at a new process for grading. And these are some of those things that you learn in a pilot. And so I wanted to make sure that all of you knew that. Our future work of standards-based grading will be a topic of conversation in the April work session. But I also wanted to let the board know that over the next week or so, you can expect some sort of communique from Mr. Hills at the high school and perhaps Ms. Hardy at the middle school as well, around sort of the good and the bad and the ugly of standards-based grading as a pilot and what our learnings are from that. And I think one of the things that we know is anytime we try something new, being a reflective, thoughtful community of learners is really important to step back and say, what did we do? What didn't we do? Right, and how can we continue to build on our successes, but also take care of those things that were less than successful. One of the things that we also learned, I think, in the pilot, just that we'll also share at the April work session, is around readiness for any initiative. There needs to be good, strong understanding of what the process is and really good, strong communication around what it's going to look like as it goes out. And that is an area that we will sort of spend some time working on moving forward. And so I just wanted to make sure the school board knew that that was happening. Another topic, and this specifically relates to our school calendar for next year. It was asked by one school board member, and perhaps it's important for all, I think it is important for all of you, is what is the process for any families that have already created plans for the first 2 weeks of school, knowing that our calendar changed in December? So there's a couple of things that I want to just call to the, or remind the board. And the first is that December timeline is the same timeline we've always used for our adoption of the calendar. That being said, we still moved it back to 2 weeks before Labor Day. And some people have already made plans for those days. So there is a policy and a regulation currently in place. It's 9.22. And in 9.22, it's around prearranged absences. And this year, we are going to continue using the prearranged absence policy and regulation. And there are, and I'll share it with you, there is a form that is filled out. And one of the things that we're looking at doing this coming year because of the change is adapting the prearranged absence form that each of the schools has to be common so that everybody's prearranged absence form looks the same. And there's one in particular that we're particularly fond of, and that's the prearranged absence form that Mary Ellen Henderson has, because it talks a little bit about sort of expectations for school and how important attendance is and the like. There is an additional and supplemental piece that goes with the high school process or any students that are taking a high school class, and that is students who are asking for an extended absence would need to fill out, if it was after the first of the year, their class, their teacher, their present grade, work that's going to be missed, and then have their teacher sign off on that. That being said, and again, going back to knowing that there are a number of students who may miss the first week or two of school because of the change of calendar, again, we are updating that request for extended absence form. We are asking in there an additional question this year affirming that your plans were made prior to the adoption of the calendar by the school board in December. And then they will send in the prearranged absence form. We'll follow, it's already automatically generated, so once you fill out the Google form, the school gets it. And then once that happens, and we're going to ask for those by March 31st. So the presumption is that anybody who's already made plans has already made those plans. So we're going to get the information out through the schools to submit your prearranged absence form by March 31st so that we know what the universe is of students that are going to be out that first week or two of school. And then we will support those families in enrollment, in the setup of their laptop, in access to Schoology, their schedule, any handouts that need to be given, flyers, forms will be either given prior to the absence or subsequent to their return to school. So I wanted to make sure that the board knew that we are, through the principals, going to put something out that talks about the prearranged absence form and what our plans are to make sure that anyone who misses that first week or two of school because of pre-existing plans, we will work with those families on a case-by-case basis. And that, I believe, unless there are any questions, is it for my superintendent's matters.
Thank you, Duncan. Are there any questions? Mr. Redding.
So it's actually less a question and more of a comment. As Dr. Nooner knows, I was the school board member who asked the question about the end of the summer. I actually disagree quite strongly that the plans need to be before the announcement of the calendar change. And my reason is this. The school board in its wisdom decided to move the calendar up to start 2 weeks before. But that means that for this summer, obviously future summers are going to be the same amount of length, but instead of an 11-week summer, and sometimes we've had a 10-week summer, we'll have a 9-week summer. And with the full spectrum of things, I actually don't think it's that material whether or not a plan was made before the calendar announcement came out. It seems to me the question is the plan otherwise reasonable? You know, there may be families that want to do college visits during that time that won't have had the opportunity because of other commitments earlier during the summer. And there are, of course, families that may not have made a specific detailed plan, but have a practice of taking vacation that particular, one of those 2 weeks, I should say. So I appreciate the effort and the willingness to work with parents. I disagree, as I said, quite strongly that the plans were made or locked down in some way before the calendar announcement ought to be pivotal. It may be a factor, but my personal view is that it should not be a binary question where the plans must have been made. And I would certainly, if that is going to be the plan, want to have a work session and discuss whether the school board wants to set a policy to the contrary. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Redinger. Are there any other comments or questions for Dr. Newton? Ms. Dimmick.
We talked about having a work session on technology, and I was wondering if that was on the radar for future.
It is on the radar for the future. It's not until probably after. Okay.
Are there any other questions for Dr. Newton, comments? All right, seeing none at the moment, I will move on then, and I'm happy because we did achieve something I was hoping we would do, which is that Ms. Singhvi is here, and I would like to call on you first for student liaison and board comments, and then we'll go this way around the table. If you have anything that you'd like to share with us. All right. Well, sorry to put you on the spot, but I'm glad that you're able to stay with us here. So, Mr. Webb. All right, then. How about if we, Ms. Downs?
Mr. Ernie?
Ms. Litton?
Sure. Well, I am soon to hand over the job of legislative liaison to Mr. Webb, but since I haven't quite handed it over yet, just a quick, kind of a quick update, because you guys all know they're sort of in the middle of session down in Richmond. So just a couple quick updates on our kind of legislative positions and where things stand. The couple of bills related to mandatory reporting of misdemeanors of school-based incidents and disorderly conduct, those are both actually moving through the House and Senate. So we think those actually look likely to pass this year. Let's see. Also, there is a bill related to solar. I know we added a solar provision in our agenda, and there's a bill that has moved through the House and is in Senate committee. So that's good news. That one's moving through. There's a few, as you guys know, there's new leadership, so there's a wide variety, I think, of new issues. There's some bills related to collective bargaining that if those move through, I think, could eventually have an impact on us, a minimum wage bill. So a variety of things happening down there. You guys probably get Lilla's reports, and I'm sure she'll continue to keep us updated, but happy to pass it on to Mr. Webb to give those in the future. Only other thing I'd mention for VSBA, the Northeast Regional Forum is coming up in May 4th for folks who want to attend that. And that's it for me.
Thank you, Ms. Lynn. Ms. Tim?
So I'm no longer a member of the Health and Wellness Committee, but I will let you know that we did two screenings of Finding Kind in January, and the committee plans a screening, two screenings of Like in March. It's about social media and like So they'll both be at Mary Ellen Henderson. There will be one after school, and the kids can watch the film and take the late bus home. And Principal Hardy and I believe one of the counselors are going to be there for discussion. And then either the night or before or after, there will be a community showing of the film.
Thank you. Mr. Webb?
Just want to take a minute, more of a personal privilege kind of moment here. Tomorrow I will be attending the funeral service of pretty much one of my biggest mentors and supporters since I was 15 or 16 years old, Bill Thomas. Bill Thomas is a person who, when I was 15 years old, I met him via then Attorney General Mary Sue Terry. That was 93 when she was campaigning for, well, actually hadn't even started the campaign, but was laying that foundation piece. She came down to Lunenburg County where I grew up at, and I kind of was kind of like what a lot of these students here tonight were doing. I was that political junkie who popped up everywhere along the way that she was at while she was down there. And within a week or so after that meeting, going to seeing her there, I received a phone call from the local librarian who happened to double as the wife of the chair of the Democratic Committee at that time, saying that she got a call that the Attorney General wanted me to come to Richmond for a meeting with her. So, of course, you know, I'm super excited about this meeting, going to Richmond. So had no idea what the meeting was for, but when I got there, it was to meet Bill Thomas, who she had, I guess, talked to him a little bit about me and helped this great young guy who's really enthusiastic and what can you do to help him. After meeting him, it was, we talked about opportunities where I ultimately took advantage of, that I took a leap of faith and left home to go to boarding school for my last 2 years of high school, that he kind of took the opportunity to help me be able to do that, to better prepare myself leaving rural Virginia, giving me a better opportunity in preparation to ultimately go on to college, which was a huge change for me, because at that point, most folks, including family members who left Lunenburg, going to the military was the option for them to leave, not necessarily going to college. And that trajectory changed for me. And from that point forward, he and his family have became my second family, that he provided a lot of firsts for me. Again, small town. Of course, at 16, I had never flown on an airplane before. Well, they call it an airport down where I grew up at, but really it's just a paved strip for a lot of folks who have maybe small little prop planes and things. Well, he sent his then law firm's private plane down to pick me up to go do the visit of my boarding school, and this was the very first time I'd ever been on a plane, myself and the pilot. So it was a very interesting, a little nervous-wracking point, but fun nevertheless. So that was the first, going to California. His daughter, who I consider as my big sister now, lived in California. Got to go out there to visit her. That was my first time going. That was the first commercial flight, going out there to visit her. But he has done that for a lot of folks within the political world, because that's where a lot of folks, he's been advisors to many governors and folks in the political world across the Commonwealth, but took the time to get to know me, took the time to become a person who I looked at as a mentor. When I decided to first run for office in 2008 for the city council, he was the very first person I talked to about this, that opportunity to do that, and got great advice from him. Got great advice from him when an important vote came on city council, which ultimately cost me my seat on the city council. But he says sometimes, you know, doing the right thing isn't always the most popular thing to do, but as long as you know you did the right thing, it's always, it's a good place for you. and I landed here, and I've loved every minute of being here on the school board. And again, with that one, you do a lot of great things on the school board, but you also get, you don't get a lot of thanks until you do something that folks kind of don't like a lot. Then you hear a lot more from them at that point. But it was a sad day when he passed away late last year, but it was, he's been a great mentor for me, and I just wanted to take a minute just to say publicly of just, you know, a person of his stature taking the time to become a mentor to me, where he didn't really have to do that, but he really did, and have been a part of his family for now well over 20 years. So it's been great. And tomorrow, having the memorial service for him is going to be a bittersweet moment to say goodbye to a person who has meant a lot to me and the life that I have been able to live right now. So thank you all for indulging me for a minute.
Thank you, Mr. Webb. And anything I could possibly say after that's going to be superfluous. So that was.
I tried, Greg. I tried. Said laugh.
I'm glad you're going to be able to do that. I'm sorry that you have to, but I'm glad you're able to. All right. So we'll move on then to our. We have two sets of minutes for approval: minutes of September 17th, 2019, and October 8th, 2019. Gravity is still working in the room. That's always nice. Unless I see any objection, I would seek unanimous consent to approve these minutes as presented. Seeing none, so ordered. And then we have two items for board review: our monthly membership and enrollment numbers, and a list of events for school board representation, which I would just highlight three items of Friday the 21st in the morning. I believe Gil Bain is still planning a topping out party for the steel at the new high school, so that's exciting. And then on the evening, International Night at TJ, and then on Saturday morning, those who can attend will be at the hard hat tour for the new high school. Sadly, I can't be there as I have to go out to JMU for another event, but there we are. So. With all of that, unless there is any final comment or thought from anyone, Ms. Downs.
Mr. Inge, it's more of a housekeeping question maybe for Marty, but now that the liaisons have been set, do we reach out to the groups, or you'll reach out to them?
Yeah, I will.
Okay.
I was going to wait until they got past tonight, and then I've got it all set up for tomorrow. Give out the form to everyone. Make sure everyone's updated.
Okay. Any other final questions or thoughts? If not, we stand adjourned. Thank you very much.